I really want to talk a little bit about some of the clinical applications of radionuclide imaging. Currently, right now, it's used primarily for oncology, cardiology, and a variety of neurological disorders. And I show this in particular because one of the main applications for tumor imaging is to determine whether patients that have cancers, this is a squamous cell carcinoma involved in the tongue base, can be treated with surgery or being treated with some type of non-surgical organ preservation therapy. And I realize that this may be a little bit unnerving for you to see, but you can imagine if you're the patient and you're having that. So eventually, the downstream effects of the radionuclide imaging and the radiopharmaceuticals are to really make important decisions that clearly directly affect how these patients are treated and eventually the outcomes. It's important as we talk about new radionuclides being identified and discovered, the clinical applications of these radiotracers, it's not only the creation of the radiotracer, but also identifying the probe, because it's not necessarily just on the radiotracer itself, it's how you get that radiotracer to the organ of interest, which in this case happens to be the tongue base. And in FDG, we all know that this is absorbed, if you will, metabolically trapped through glycolysis. This is a slide written in 2007, and again, we only have 5 minutes, but very briefly, if you really want to get a nice overview of the various types of radiotracers that are used in oncology, I certainly would recommend this paper. This was in Clinical Cancer Research in 2007. What's interesting is that this radiotracer, now you can't see in the back, is FDG, it's fluorodeoxyglucose. This was developed in the early 1990s. My first grant was actually with FDG at the time. It wasn't even on a spec scanner, on a PET scanner, it was on a spec scanner. And this was in 1992, and now we're in 2016. So I trained in the last century, which is difficult for me to say. But I figured over that period of time, there would be more radiotracers that would be clinically applicable. But actually, this really still is the benchmark. Now, there are other tracers that have been developed. Choline right now is under investigation, predominantly to evaluate prostate cancer. There are a variety of tracers for amino acids. And also, I won't go through all of them, but the point is that many of these are used in the applications I talked about before. One of the areas that we did look at was C11 methionine. So fluorodeoxyglucose, FDG, is the F18 label to glucose. It's taken into the cell, it goes to the first step of glycolysis, and then it's metabolically trapped, and it accumulates in those tumors that have higher metabolic activity. This type of radiotracer methionine is looking for increased activity of amino acid transporters in the vascular bed, and there was a lot of promise at the time with methionine. And as you can see here, on the left-hand side, this was a patient that has a brain tumor. This was the uptake seen with FDG, and this was the uptake seen in the methionine. You can see there was actually more uptake because the focus on amino acids. But unfortunately, this never really caught hold for a variety of limitations with the methionine. But again, just an example about some of the radiotracers that had a lot of promise but never came into fruition. In the current state, if you will, the radiotracer and the imaging agent that has the most enthusiasm and the tailwind is this right now. This is the amyloid binding agents for Alzheimer's disease. So this is F18, you can say that. Try saying Mukherji, that's my last name. We call it Vizamil, is the trade name. But this is the agent that's currently being investigated for Alzheimer's disease. So on the left-hand side is a negative scan, and on the right-hand side, this is a patient with Alzheimer's disease. And you can see there's much more uptake seen throughout the brain. So this is the agent right now that's undergoing a large-scale international trial. We actually make this agent in the basement of radiology. But right now we're in this strange area of we need to be able to innovate, but there also has to be a lot of value. And that value is determined by outcomes and unfortunately by our payers, which determine our reimbursements. But this is the agent right now that's having the most interest. In cardiology, for cardiac viability, we're still using F18-FDG. Now for cardiac perfusion, this still is using a single radionuclide. A lot of emphasis was placed on rubidium at one point, but this is difficult to make. Ammonium is still used, but it's very unstable with a very short half-life. This type of receptor imaging, somatostatin receptor imaging for neuroendocrine tumors, has had a lot of success. The agent that typically has been used is for indium-111, and it's been recently tagged to gallium, carbon, yttrium, and lutetium. These can be imaged with PET, where this is still imaged with a standard nuclear medicine camera. And for thyroid disease, it's treated with I-121, but it's primarily used with F-18, although it has been transferred to DOPA and gallium as well, too. So there has been a little bit of transition, if you will, in some of these new agents, but still, the benchmark is still F-18. Now, I realize the screen is small. I realize nobody in the back can see it. This is just a bird's eye view of some of the recent radiopharmaceuticals that are under investigation. None of these have really hit prime time. Just briefly, it's manganese, cobalt, copper, gallium, arsenic, bromide, yttrium, zirconium, and iodine. Again, a lot of new radiopharmaceuticals that are under investigation, but still, these really have not been fully FDA approved, and the true clinical applications, although they are being investigated, have not been confirmed. So I didn't have a timer, but I think I'm at 5 minutes, I hope, and I'll be happy to have any questions.
Yeah, I'll just take some questions.
What again was that reference you mentioned?
Yeah, it's the one with the color slides.
Yeah.
Yes. It was Worcester, I can go back, I think. It's Worcester, Wester. It's W-E-S-T-E-R, Clinical Cancer Research. I strongly recommend reading that because although it was written in 2007, to be honest with you, not much has changed over time. Yeah, I was talking with someone earlier and there was, it's the enthusiasm, it's hard to really capture the true enthusiasm that we in the medical community have for the creation of these radioisotopes. Because divisions of radiology used to be called nuclear medicine divisions. They're now being called molecular imaging divisions. And it's not just branding. We're always looking for the next big thing. And there's a tremendous enthusiasm and hope that some of these new radionuclides and radioisotopes that are developed will actually be able to provide more information than is currently available. Yes, sir.
So why do you think over almost 10 years not much has changed in terms of the landscape? What do you think of it?
With F-18?
Yeah.
For a variety of reasons, I think, number one, when you give agents such as choline, all of these, the probes in which we're trying to target are ubiquitous, they're all over the body. And in order to identify enough uptake in an area of abnormality, there has to be enough difference in the target abnormality versus the background. And F-18, when you have a lot of uptake in a tumor, it's still surprisingly greater than the background. So background is one of them.
Okay.
Number two is a half-life. If you're going to create something, then it has to be shipped elsewhere. Not everyone can have a cyclotron in their basement like we do. So there has to be enough time for it to create the particles, the radioisotopes, and transfer them. So part of it is just practicality. Number three is just in general availability and concern. So glucose is a very easy agent. It's not a radioactive isotope. It's not an inert metal. And then the last one is it's just somehow just stood the test of time. It's really hard to say. It's a very, very stable agent. So it's not because of lack of trying. There are just a lot of confounding factors, and this is still within the benchmark.
What is the quantities needed?
For FDG?
Yes.
I don't know the exact doses. I can get that for you, but I don't know the exact dose it's given. But something in millicuries, I believe, but don't hold me to that.
It's millicuries or curies or?
I don't know.
It's about 10 millicuries.
10 millicuries?
For only a scan of a large person.
That was close. Thanks, yeah.
You mentioned that half-life is an issue. And if it's too sharp, then you cannot use it. So I consider that as an opportunity.
It could be an opportunity, yeah. Yeah. So part of the things like ammonium actually is a terrific tool to look for cardiac perfusion.
Right.
But the challenge is to try to get something that has such a short half-life, produce it here, then take it over to another hospital, and without it completely deteriorating.